So I want to talk about community building, and I know I started this morning, you know, guesstimating that maybe like 40% of the readmissions issue is manageable within the walls of the hospital, and then, you know, you just have to get out of the walls of the hospital. So anyway, that's what I want to talk about now. All right, so really, this is why the solution to readmissions is community collective action, and why the solution to community collective action is you. That's the main point we need to make. So by you, I mean within your industry, when I was talking about those lateral coalitions, and then you as a participant that goes across your industry to the greater community. Now, when I say community, I not only mean medical service providers, I mean non-medical service providers. You really cannot solve this problem without the social services sector. And I also mean groups of people who live in your community. So I sometimes call them RPs, you know, real people, not medical providers. Okay, so to jump to the conclusion here, I used to put this as the conclusion, but I might as well orient you. This is what I think. It's clear that somebody has to do something, and it's incredibly pathetic that it has to be us. Now, this is Jerry Garcia. but it really is it's the reason it has to be a community framework. You know, so like, who would you like to have regulate how things go in the place that you live and work and know far more about than regulators do? The real issue is to develop the kind of infrastructure, and I don't, without specifying what that infrastructure should be, that can allow you as a community to kind of take charge, manage, set priorities for how it is that you think medical services and non-medical services and really health management should go in the place that you call here. So I want to point out that I think part of our problem is very basic, and it's this term healthcare. You know, we toss around the term healthcare. Well, I actually think that allows us to be very, very sloppy, and that we should be clear whether we're talking about medical services or health, things that contribute to and maintain people's health. So when you think about it, the problem now with managing readmissions from a pure medical provider point of view is that really the medical services are kind of a small part of what people need to manage themselves within their community at their optimal achievement of health and function. You know, of course, hospitals are totally on the firing line for readmissions, because the problem is you're not at risk for readmission until you've been admitted. You know, you guys are right in the middle of this problem based on how we measure it. But aside from how you measure a readmission, meaning you have had to have had a contact with the hospital, really the greater picture is to properly adjust the role of acute care, meaning hospital services, on behalf of a community that you know, wants to live at optimal function and health. All right, so this is a picture of deforestation. So I've gotten quite enamored of the Common Pool Resource Management work, which is an economic theory. Are there economists in the room? Because I'm not an economist, and you can just correct me if I misstate anything. All right, so Common Pool Resource Management has really developed over about the last 30 years, and it's largely developed in the field of natural resources management. So, you know, so commons refers to a specific thing, which often was a grazing plot in the middle of a town or village. So, you know, Boston Commons was at one point a grazing field. The economics of commons, it was assumed that common property, something that benefits sort of the general community, needed to be heavily regulated, because the experience of commons is that a large percentage of them fail. And that is because the economic incentives to each individual is to put another animal on the commons. So, you know, if you put on two cows or add an extra goat or whatever, you know, your family benefits 100% from the products of that animal. You know, if you're not paying for access to that common property, or you're not doing something to contribute to the sustaining of that common resource, the resource degrades over time. So this kind of came to general public opinion through this article that Garrett Hardin published in 1968. It was actually his comments he delivered as a presentation of the National Academy of Science, and he was actually talking about the fact that the U.S. had no population policy. which we still don't. But anyway, and his talk was labeled The Tragedy of the Commons. And, you know, it became quite popular to talk about the tragedy of the commons. And in fact, in the medical literature, there's a number of editorials and other folks who have discussed, you know, the reason that Medicare, well, Medicaid expenditures just keep going up and up and up is that it's a classic commons problem. And, you know, as we all know, commons fail. And so myself, it wasn't until about 2 or 3 years ago that I heard for the first time the word commons in a sentence that did not contain the word tragedy. I always thought, everybody knows commons are a tragedy. and so what happened is I discovered the work of Dr. Elmer Ostrom. Do people know who that is? She just died yesterday. I just went out and found her album. Anyway, so she headed a team at University of Indiana starting about in the 70s. What happened in the 70s is that there was this real backlash against government management of all kinds of what we had viewed as common properties before then. So, you know, the airlines, as the example I remember the most clearly. And so with regard to, for instance, natural resources is a great example. So forests, like in India, the first picture I think is a forest from India. So let's say that we believe the world needs more forests, and you know, we in wherever it is believe we want to protect this forest. So it's a commonly owned international forest land, so it's a common property problem. So the way governments manage that is often to fence them off. And, you know, so we're talking millions of miles of fencing, and you know, you put concertina wire on it or whatever. Put cameras in the places where people tend to violate the boundaries, and then they take satellite photographs to show whether or not degradation is happening. Well, by the time the satellite photograph shows what you have in the first picture, you know, there's clearly a problem. And so there was a lot of belief starting in about the 70s and 80s that common property management just doesn't work, and it's real expensive. You need layers and layers and layers of regulation for, you know, who can be there and when and why, and you have to do surveillance and, you know, all that type of stuff, and it still doesn't actually protect, it often fails. So there was this belief that we should be privatizing all of these types of resources, that if we privatized them, at least somebody would have the economic incentive to protect that. So this was when Dr. Ostrom began her work in late 70s, early 80s. And what she did is she went all around the world and looked at something like 350 examples of enduring commons arrangements, what she called enduring commons arrangements. And I think that meant commons that had not been degraded in, like, I don't know, more than 100 years, that were essentially managed by local populations as a common resource. And so she, they did extensive interviews, they did qualitative and quantitative data collection, put the whole thing into a, you know, model to look at, you know, do regression analysis, you know, what is it about these kind of experiments that leads them to work. And in the end, she couldn't really find statistically an answer. But what she did is she found what she called eight common principles. If you have these eight principles, you have the conditions in which an enduring commons arrangement may thrive. And it really all came to collective action and collective impact, basically. Cooperative arrangements that had enough self-monitoring and regulation that they endured. So I'm just going to go over the six that are most applicable to healthcare. But so what you found is, you know, if you want to protect a forest or you want the local population to protect a forest, first of all, it has to have very clearly defined boundaries. And you know, that makes complete sense. So if you own property that, you know, backs onto Yosemite, for instance, you have the right to cut down trees in your yard. It's very important that you know this tree is in my yard and that tree is in Yosemite. So you have to be very clear about the borders of what it is that you want to protect. That thing that is quite effective is allowing the local population, the people whose property actually borders on the forest. So when you think about it, who cares the most about Yosemite, probably? I mean, really, who really, really cares about Yosemite? You know, it's the people whose property backs onto it. So first of all, there probably is an actual economic value to that, right? They probably pay a premium to own that property. They probably want to protect that investment by ensuring that, you know, Yosemite isn't sold off to developers or something, or that it's, you know, degraded in some way. And they also probably really love it. You know, they have emotional attachment to it. That's why they chose to pay top dollar and live there. So if you say to folks who actually live by a property, you know, we really want your help in protecting it, and that is a number of things. First of all, it engages them in helping to set the rules. Secondly, when you think about it, who's going to know if you take a couple of trees out of Yosemite? Well, who's going to be first, well before the satellite photographs are going to show this? Who's going to know first? What's that?
The people that live there.
Exactly, your neighbors. So your neighbors are going to be the first ones to know, and your neighbors are going to know whether you're just taking an occasional tree or you invited them a logging company. So what they found is that in these enduring arrangements, that if you allow the local population to participate within federal regulations to say, we know this forest is sustainable if each of us gets 2 trees a year. You know, I mean, we know that that's what we need to keep the forest healthy, and so we're going to take that. We will take that, and we will set these rules. So congruence between the rules that govern it, who can appropriate resources, and the people who live there. Thirdly, this has to be a decision that includes kind of everybody. If you say, well, you know, anybody who lives around here whose last name begins with S can say exactly how many trees we all should take out, you know, that's not going to work. It really has to be sort of a collective choice arrangement that involves everybody. Fourthly, this is key. The people who can appropriate need to have the ability to monitor each other. So with forests, it's just like you would see, you would know. You'd be the first people to know. So if people can actually monitor each other's behavior with regard to protecting this resource, they also need to have access to easy sanctions. So, you know, it's asking a lot to turn your neighbor into the police. I mean, you don't really want to have to manage monitoring your neighbor like that. You need to have sort of a town council where you discuss this or, you know, something like that. It's kind of easy mechanism that's quick and cheap. It doesn't rely on lawsuits that take, you know, a couple of years to come, be effective and to come to decisions. And then sixth, you need these graduated sanctions. So there is a difference between taking a couple of extra trees and inviting in a logging company. And the rules that govern this common property arrangement need to reflect that. All right, so what does this have to do with healthcare? Well, I discovered this theory when we just wanted to study Grand Junction, Colorado. So Grand Junction, because you know we're the Colorado QIO, they perform it close to benchmark level on everything. And yet, if you look in the Dartmouth Atlas, they're the cheapest market next to the Chiefs. They were 304th most expensive out of 306 hospital referral regions in the original Dartmouth Atlas in 1992. And the most recent one, they were 301st. So they're the only region that's really stayed in that five most efficient areas for the entire duration of the Dartmouth Atlas. So we actually recruited, should put that in quotes, them to participate in one of our early transitions of care pilots, mostly because we wanted to study how they did it. We really wanted to spend some time understanding how they think about their care coordination processes and how they enact them. So what we had felt when we went in there is, oh, I'm sure they must have awesome process management, and they do. We verified their data, their readmission rates are, you know, pretty low. Their admission rates were pretty low. But really when it came down, what it finally came down to is we didn't know how to explain what we were finding there because we'd never really seen anything that worked quite this well before. So for instance, when we said, oh, we would like to map, you know, your discharge processes, and then we're going to go to the skilled nursing facility and map their admission process. And really, seriously, the director of quality improvement opened a drawer and took out a map and said, well, you might start with this. So at the time, it was remarkable that they had a map. Secondly, when we checked it was an accurate process map. Thirdly, it was far more simple than any other process map that we had developed for other hospitals around the hospital discharge process. So when we kept asking why, well, it turned out that the hospitals and nursing homes routinely meet, like every 6 months, they have a joint quality meeting. And in fact, if the nursing home does not show up at this quality meeting, they will lose referrals. So the hospital feels that their post-acute providers need to meet with them around what they're trying in terms of quality, how their quality is going, the degree to which the hospital needs to be helpful on their side. But this is essentially a meeting at which attendance is important, and it's a discussion meeting around mutual process and mutual quality metrics. So the more questions we ask, the more it really became clear that what they have is sort of a culture of collaborative action. So when I discovered Conoco Resource, I realized, you know, they have these six things. So now, Grand Junction, and I think a number of you here in the room have the advantage in a lot of ways when it comes to managing the resource of medical inputs for the population in your community. You have an advantage if you are an airplane community, where you know what your borders are. People don't have to explain to you where your community is, who your population is, and who the providers are that you have to work with. In Grand Junction, they started their own local HMO. They actually were concerned, bordering on outraged, by the passage of Medicare and Medicaid, so, you know, in the late 60s, because they felt that was going to be federal interference in their practice patterns. And they were so outraged that they felt they needed to start their own payer so they could manage the payment within their community. So this is when the HMO Act was passed. They started Rocky Mountain Health Plans so that they could manage what they really wanted to do is make sure that primary care physicians were not at a disadvantage by seeing Medicaid patients, because they felt that would degrade sort of the community cohesiveness and the quality of care to everybody if that was, you know, kind of carved out as a separate population. So that's one of the first things this payer was to do, was to adjust payments so that Medicaid paid as well as commercial insurance, and they to primary care, specifically to primary care. So anyway, Rocky Mountain Health Plans has now grown quite a bit, and they're the statewide provider. I don't know if they are outside of Colorado, but anyway. In terms of this participation of appropriators in the decision-making process, well, once they decided to start, you know, a community HMO, they really started having a lot of very, pointed meetings about how are we going to manage utilization in this community, because now we're all, you know, at risk under this HMO that we all started because we wanted to manage payment within our community. So among the many things that happened with regard to that is the Medical Society agreed that their Medical Society members would be openly ranked, meaning openly ranked with regard to physicians with for utilization metrics. So to this day, Mesa County Medical Society publishes rankings of who uses the most CT scans here, and it's sent out to all physicians, you know, by name. So if you're the top utilizer of something or other, that becomes, I think, uncomfortable for physicians. They don't like to be there. That's not to say that there aren't reasons why some order more than others, but anyway, the point is it's transparent. So if you're doing your job, you're doing your part to protect resource utilization, you have the ability to check whether or not your competitors, let's face it, are doing their part. That's effective monitoring on appropriators. Graduated sanctions is Rocky Mountain Health Plans has payment incentives for efficient practices. There's a lot of pride around where you are in this ranking list. And then conflict resolution mechanisms. Now there can be, you know, you can be dropped from the health plan if you are just say, I don't care, I want to order more CAT scans. But a lot of it really comes down to a sense of social belonging. So, you know, as one of these docs said, well, you know, if you're a jerk, you just count on running into that person at the grocery store after work, and it would just be really uncomfortable. So, you know, the very fact that people work together and know each other is a type of moderating mechanism for people to step back and say, you know, I like living and working here, and so I have an incentive to be sure it works well here on behalf of us all, because that benefits me. So it's very much a common core resource arrangement. So when you think about readmissions, so readmissions really is the tip of the iceberg of appropriate acute care service utilization, really. And that is the expensive part of healthcare, you know, right now. So when you think about it, this is why we believe that the best way to make progress is to identify yourselves as a community, start to monitor yourself as a community, get to know each other and work together as a global community of providers supplying the majority of services to a local and clearly defined population. So it's really based on a lot of this background work in Conoco Resource Arrangement. So first of all, you know, readmissions is certainly not totally a hospital project. We've been through that. We start to measure readmissions with discharge because that's the definition of a readmission. But really, you know, hospitals are also receivers, and I think they also have very flawed receiving experiences. So hospitals, unlike other providers, really do have to take anybody who stumbles through the door of the emergency room, and they're regulated on that, regardless of the fact that nobody sent you any information. So I just want to acknowledge that we know that's true. Because we're measuring at the time of hospital discharge, I think it often comes down into talking to you about what we think the hospital should send. But you know, the real problem is both a sender and a receiver problem. It's a community problem really largely because, elderly folks, though I work with Medicare, they depend on a large array of services, only part of which are medical. And we would hope that the minority of those inputs would be medical. And with regard to everything else, they seek those services, those support services, close to where they live and or their family. So it really does become a finite location problem. Do you live in a location that has a capacity to support you at home or know you? So in every way that the key to reducing readmissions is to get a coalition of local providers who have the same vision for how they should be serving this local population that has a lot of non-medical and medical needs. So here's our driver diagram. Why are people readmitted? The answer to why we haven't solved the system support is because we have typically not developed the community infrastructure for setting and achieving common goals around things such as readmissions. So here's another way to think about it. This is a picture that's often used to describe dysfunction. Really, there's a lot of strengths to what's going on here. So, you wouldn't want to go have a meeting in the C-suite of the hospital to decide how it is that you should interface with home health or skilled nursing facilities. Like, you really would want a home health caseworker to be a part of that meeting. You need people who are absolute experts at what they do so that you can connect it to what you do. And there's many, many sort of provider types that need to take their detailed site-specific expertise and contribute them to mutual projects. So Interact is a great example of how that can go. But you also need the type of coalition that can represent the community to set priorities, track progress towards achieving those priorities, who can step back and say, I think it's an elephant. Now, to me, the key thing that this little cow guy should be doing with regard to readmissions is making available, at the very least, 30-day readmission rates for the population. So, that's a real organizing metric. So there's going to be a lot of people doing a lot of different things. But if you all can agree to come together on behalf of changing this single sort of unifying metric, it becomes easier to keep things together and stay the course, tracking that for the population, not for any given provider. So this is a thought that has really taken hold beyond the QIO program. So I just wanted to point out, these are CMS slides that I borrowed. So this is, they might not be quite up to date, but currently funded projects to use community coalition structures for achieving population improvements with regard to readmissions. So that first was the 14 communities. Now there's more than 39 CCTP awardees now, but these have been added. The ADRCs, are people familiar with ADRCs? Adult Disability Resource Centers? Oh, you.
Oklahoma structures their ADRCs a little differently in a lot of sense, too. So
Eleanor will talk to you about ADRCs later. the Administration on Aging, which is a sister organization to CMS, they've now been rolled into the much larger Administration on Community Living. But the Administration on Aging funds community-based services for older Americans. Now, interestingly, AOA defines older Americans as 60 or older, and Medicare defines them as 65 or older. But anyway, there's a lot of community support dollars also coming from HHS into every state and every community. So those are a lot of the organizations that are applying for the CCTP demonstration project. So they're the purple boxes. The communities that have been recruited by QIOs who, within about the first 6 months, there's now a number more. They're also trying to replicate this. So there's a lot of similar experiments going on. So I want to talk about our experience trying to take what has started out as a medical provider type of project and move it into much more of a community coalition framework. So we had done a lot of talking, so this is starting in 2008 in the previous scope of work. You know, we had done a lot of talking about community collective action. So we had been to Grand Junction and we understood that this is really where there's a fair amount of leverage. And we had convened, you know, our providers, our hospitals and nursing home and home health providers, and we were actually making progress. Well, about halfway, so 18 months or so into the project, you know, we realized, well, we talk a lot about community, but we really have not reached out to the community, you know, as such. So we decided to have a big meeting in which the hospitals really formed a panel, and they talked about what they were doing to try to reduce risk of readmission. And we had it as a recreation center. We did not want to have this at a medical facility. And we invited a lot of people who were stakeholders, like a lot of them were nursing home administrators and home health administrators, but many of them came from the social support services sector. And then there were some people who were just like real people that came to the meeting. And you know, we had about 200 attendees. This was a Monday afternoon. That was the only time we could work out with the recreation center. So from 4 to 8 p.m., and there were just these little box sandwich lunches, which one of the hospitals had agreed to provide. So it wasn't really what you call a swanky sort of an opportunity, but you know, people came and they stayed the entire time. And in the question and answer period, what happened really was that people stood up and gave personal testimony, really, about how they had been affected by this issue, either good stories or bad stories. I mean, some of them tearful. You know, I just want to solve this for my father, or whatever. I mean, people actually cared a lot. So people wanted to volunteer to help. So at that point, we sort of had a tiger by the tail, like, wow, we just had 40 people volunteer to help. So Risa Hayes, the project manager in Colorado, she was all prepared for this. So we signed them up into action teams, volunteer action teams, and these volunteer action teams met monthly. 10 to 15 people per action team, two of them combined, so in the end it was just four. And they produced specific products. They gave themselves, they assigned themselves work, they developed work plans, and they produced products for the effort, the community-based effort to reduce readmissions. So this is just, I know you can't read this, but this is the four action teams and examples of their work plans and what they wanted to produce. This is my favorite example. This is a personal health record that was produced by one of the teams. It's based on Dr. Coleman's personal health record, but they changed a few things about it. They vetted it through a number of settings that had been participating in the action team, and they collected money from each other to print it. We didn't know federal dollars went into this. They collected money from themselves and other local businesses and printed, I think, 20,000 of these to be used in hospitals and pharmacies and, I think, grocery stores. So if you ask the community to help, they will. I mean, be prepared to have a lot of people offer to help you. That's, you know, good news, and it's really good news, but you have to think, you know, about how you might leverage that. But the point is, everybody says they're short of resources. Our experience was, if you ask people to help, they really do want to, they care about this issue, especially if you keep it very local. This is the place that we want to solve this issue. And you know, here's what we, the hospital, are doing. All right, so this is the setting-specific cluster. This is another type of coalition that I've already talked about. Case three, these are receivers work groups. Now, the most difficult constituency for us to reach for a lot of reasons was individual physician offices. And that's just because, you know, you're asking them for a donation of money to ask them to come to a meeting during the day. You know, they're production-based. It's really difficult for them to show up to ordinary daytime meetings. And many of them are very small, so you have to meet with, you know, 80 of them to get a, you know, critical mass of physicians. So one of the communities formed just a physician receivers work group, and they had some evening meetings. They set out an agenda to standardize expectations, standardize information transfer, standardize the process by which they wanted the hospital to get them information after discharge, and agree to some way to measure adherence. And in a lot of ways, your receivers are the ones who can measure the quality of your discharge the best. You know, they can just keep a hatch mark. How often do do I receive, you know, of all the discharges that I was responsible for, was this one, you know, complete and timely or not? You know, just have them take Hatchmark type data and feed it back to you, you know, per month. Yep, 80% of them were just right. Or, you know, only 10% of them had, you know, medications filled out or something like that. So these receivers work groups are quite powerful. And then case four, this is something that we're trying now, and this is the collective action, collective impact framework. So this is, if you Google collective impact, it will take you to this and now a follow-up article that is about an education initiative that started in Cincinnati. So what happened is exactly like what we're trying to do. There were many organizations funded to work on various aspects of high school graduation rates or something, like a huge number. There are government agencies that are involved in this, you know, such as school districts. There were a bunch of, you know, advocacy groups and nonprofits doing various and sundry improvement projects related to education quality. And so what they did is somebody agreed to form this backbone structure and say, we will take charge of convening meetings for everybody to learn to work together, for setting a common measure, for, you know, at least one common measure, for setting common goals, you know, structuring the process. They identified 53 indicators that they wanted to measure improvement on. And through just having an organization step forward to say, we are going to develop this collective impact backbone for what you all are already funded to do. So this did not come with additional funding. They made progress on 34 out of 53 indicators in like 12 months. So I'd encourage people to read this. It's really quite motivating. So what they found is the five conditions that they felt most explained collective success was having a common agenda. You know, we are going to meet every month to talk about high school graduation rates, or we're going to meet every month to, you know, set priorities around, dissect the things we need to do around reducing 30-day readmissions, to set up standard measures. Well, you know, the QIO has Medicare claims data with 30-day readmissions by zip code. So you can define your community however you want to. You know, the zip codes can be added up and you can see whether your trend is getting better. Have mutually reinforcing activities. So, and we already know, certainly at the HIN and the QIO level, there's a lot of mutually reinforcing activities around, you know, people who are providing technical assistance to hospitals. There's a lot of mutually reinforcing activities going on between hospitals and nursing homes and mental health agencies. So it's really having a structure for leveraging mutually reinforcing activities, staying in communication, and having a place where that gets discussed, vetted, and tracked. All right, so back to who's in my community. This is, remember, the framework for developing a community-based care transitions improvement. Who's in my community? That's zip code overlap. Root cause analysis, that comes from data and patient interviews. Number three, drivers and settings. Now we know what our driver is because we did a root cause analysis. We know which settings we want to work with, need to work with, and volunteer to work with us. That's how we're going to know what interventions we should start with. Then you need to become a part of a backbone agency. So I think the HINs, QIOs, they're all folks who can help set up in a community a sort of a backbone infrastructure for having a common place to come and discuss mutually reinforcing activities and track progress. Okay, so the backbone agency, the purpose to track progress, to maintain focus, to help drive accountability. So how do you know everybody's doing what they said they were going to do? At some point you might want to be accountable and to hold others accountable. So this is what you can do through a collective impact framework that might be a little uncomfortable, just saying, you know, I'm going to call those people up and say, you are not sending us the right kind of patients, you know. So it's a little bit better to do that, I think, within this collective impact framework. It's a good way to represent the work to the population. Like I said, our story around just asking the community to help participate. And it doesn't have to be you, the hospital. It can be us, the community coalition. This is what we are working on. This is what we need ideas around. This is what we need volunteers to do for us. Here's the map of our community. Here's how we're doing so far. I'm going to trim that for you quarterly. And ultimately, you would want to select and empower a community-based organization that can apply for the CCTP program. Okay, so there's really three types of coalitions that I see being effective in this kind of work. So one is this community coalition that I just talked about, the backbone agency. The other is these coalitions, these lateral coalitions of providers. Within your own industry, I guess everybody here is a hospital system. But you just have hospitals saying together, we're going to standardize discharge in this way, and we're going to share strategies with each other, we're going to share data on how we're doing with each other. We want the other segments of the medical care system and by extension the health care system to participate with us in this. And then the third type of coalition is really open community meeting, kind of community meeting that involves people. All people are likely to be patients, even us, someday. The influence of everyday people who live and work and care about the community where you serve, you can get tremendous, probably the best ideas and the best assistance for moving forward from tapping that resource. Okay, in every case, what we found is that these are key things. Now, a few champions is really great. Often just by showing people data, champions will jump up and comment because they care a lot. So just like the case of Harlingen and the nursing homes, when those medical directors saw that data, they became passionate champions. And I would say that by going completely transparent with what you're doing, that is how champions emerge. Belief in the goal over attribution, so that is sort of the key concept of collective impact, is just like common pool resource arrangement, we will get to something I value better than if I take individual action. By all of us hanging in together and making this a great place to live and work, that's really, in the end, what I care about the most. Whether or not I can order a couple of extra PET scans or whatever, some highly reimbursed service is actually less important. Certainly relationship building is a key required skill for this. So what we found is, this is my favorite lesson in leadership, I think that there's been so much recent discussion around the notion of community as the necessary unit for real transformational improvement in medical services management. I mean, I don't think that's a hard sell anymore. So when we started talking about this maybe 5 years ago or so, you had to explain this to everybody, why it's a community problem and not just a hospital problem or a nursing home problem. And I think people are now hearing that message. Would you all agree with that? Or maybe it's just the world I move in, but would you agree there's pretty general awareness that this needs to be a community? Okay, some do and some don't. There's some yeses and no's. But even in places where they have really high recognition of this, and especially now that there's this potential payment opportunity on the table through the CBO, and we find people who agree with that in concept, but coalitions still are falling apart or not coming together as well because there's a lot of angst around who's going to lead. Who's going to lead this? Am I going to come to a coalition meeting that's being managed by and I receive the invitation from that competitor that I just don't trust? So we're actually seeing people understand the coalition, this is the right way to go, but having a difficulty understanding what leaders should step forward to get the coalition together and to be the leader. This is a key lesson in leadership that I think explains it really better than I could.
If you've learned a lot about leadership and making a movement, then let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons. First, of course, a leader needs the guts to stand alone and look ridiculous. But what he's doing is so simple, it's almost instructional. This is key. You must be easy to follow. Now here comes the first follower with a crucial role. He publicly shows everyone else how to follow. Notice how the leader embraces him as an equal. So it's not about the leader anymore, it's about them, plural. Notice how he's calling to his friends to join in. See, it takes guts to be a first follower. You stand out and you brave ridicule yourself. Being a first follower is an underappreciated form of leadership. The first follower transforms a lone nut into a leader. If the leader is the flint, the first follower is the spark that really makes the fire. Now here's the second follower. This is a turning point. It's proof the first has done well. Now it's not a lone nut, and it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd, and a crowd is news. A movement must be public. Make sure outsiders see more than just the leader. Everyone needs to see the followers, because new followers emulate followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, then three more immediately. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point, and now we have a movement. As more people jump in, it's no longer risky. If they were on the fence before, there's no reason not to join in now. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, and they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. And over the next minute, you'll see the rest who prefer to stay part of the crowd, because eventually they'd be ridiculed for not joining. And ladies and gentlemen, that is how a movement is made. So let's recap what we've learned. If you are a version of the shirtless dancing guy, all alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals, making everything clearly about the movement, not you. Be public, be easy to follow. But the biggest lesson here, did you catch it? Leadership is over-glorified. Yes, it started with the shirtless guy, and he'll get all the credit, but you saw what really happened. It was the first follower that transformed a lone nut into a leader. There's no movement without the first follower. See, we're told that we all need to be leaders, but that would be really ineffective. The best way to make a movement, if you really care, is to courageously follow and show others how to follow. When you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first person to stand up and join in.
Who has seen that already? Yeah, I love this. I still laugh every time I see it. But so I think that so even in places that are really quite sophisticated about understanding coalition, this is the barrier that we are running into now, is this fear of loss of control by following another's lead. And yet, I do think that is a critical thing that really needs to happen. When that starts to happen in a large number of places, we will solve a lot of our problems, I think, in particular with possible readmissions. So one of the skills that Eleanor talked a little bit about this. So once we realized that we were probably doing community organizing, so this is another example of where I went to a conference and it became clear where our gaps were. But you know, it suddenly occurred to me there are people who know and have formal training how to do community organizing. You know, we had spent a lot of time kind of, looking at claims data and inviting people to come, and then over time figuring out, we need to really expand this and involve people who are not in medical services, and then we need to expand this and involve people who just live here, you know, potential patients, and then I realized, you know, we just need to become community organizers. So we did take a class at Harvard from Marshall Gans. Do folks here know of him? He is, has quite an illustrious career as a community organizer. We took his class through Harvard. It was really rigorous. We had to do a community organizing project to learn all of this, and we felt it was quite effective in helping us develop coalitionness. So now the QIOs have had at least two people trained now in basic techniques in community organizing. But in general, you know, community organizing asks you to contribute to something you believe in based on your values. So this was really a helpful message for me to hear. So, you know, as a physician, I think, you know, there's this sense that talking about my own personal values is unprofessional. That if I were to talk about, you know, really who I am and what brings me to the work and why I care so much, that would be unprofessional. But you know what Dr. Gans says is you should never do anything that represents a cause you believe in. That's not right. You shouldn't do things for causes. You should do things because based on your own personal who you are and your personal values, that you believe this is a goal that's critically important to you as a person. So one of the key tools that we learned that I thought was very, very good was the telling of personal narratives. So what Dr. Gans says, if you don't tell your story, somebody else will. But anyway, if you learn to really get clear with yourself about what draws you to this work based on your own personal values, who you are, where you came from, the values of your parents, that type of thing. It is an invaluable tool for getting together a coalition and keeping a coalition together when competitive concerns start to rear their heads. You know, it is likely that all of your competitors agree with you, basically, in the values that bring you to your work. They probably all share similar values with regard to reducing or eliminating unwanted readmissions. Certainly, they will share your values around things like just improving care coordination or care transitions. You know, so I know another community organizing technique is to identify the nightmare that exists now that you are trying to eliminate. So my version of the nightmare is, you know, I don't want it ever happen again that somebody, you know, old, in pain, and sick, sitting at home wondering, what should I do now? You know, what happens now? I mean, think of how that feels. That is a nightmare, and I think it happens a lot. Anyway, those core values, I think, are very useful to talk about, both for me and us, the coalition that we want to be developing and working through, and then the message is now. So Dr. Gann says the message is me, us, now. And if you can craft narratives like this, you can sell your vision. And that's a lot of what community organizing is. We're going to keep ourselves together. We're going to distribute leadership on behalf of the cause. And we're going to do that in part through tools such as personal narratives of mine, us as a group, and why now is the time.